Hi, my name is Richard Vaudrey, and welcome to Melbourne Symphony Orchestra's Beethoven Bites. In this bite, we're going to learn about orchestration and discover the different timbres available to a composer within the symphony orchestra. Then we'll take a look at how the great Ludwig van Beethoven set about using these timbres to manipulate our emotional responses to his music. Seventh Symphony of Beethoven is a great place to start when learning about orchestration. If we take a look at the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra, right here, we see Beethoven uses a relatively small orchestra for this symphony. This is known as a classical orchestra and is generally between 30 to 60 musicians. Double basses are just out of sight to the right. The symphony orchestra, as we know it today, had its roots in the early classical period, with composers such as Mozart, Haydn, starting to write for large ensembles or orchestras. Gradually, composers including Beethoven started adding instruments to these ensembles. Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, for example, added trombones, piccolo, and a double bassoon, breaking the norm and increasing his timbral options. If we fast forward in history to the Romantics, such as Wagner or Mahler, they took this to the extreme, requiring orchestras of around 120 musicians. Here, in Beethoven 7, we have a great example of all the basic essentials: strings, wind, brass, and percussion. This gives us the perfect starting point to understand the instruments in the composer's toolbox. Orchestration can be thought of as simply how the composer utilizes the sounds of these instruments in the orchestra. We can think of these sounds in two categories. Firstly, the sound of each instrument family. This is the combined sound, or similarity in sound between the instruments within a particular family. Secondly, the sound of an individual instrument, or solo instrument. In a nutshell, orchestration is how the composer combines and arranges the sounds of the instruments. The cool thing is, each one of these instrumental families, and each individual instrument, has a unique sound or timbre. These differing timbres all have their own emotional sound. Deciding which instrument to call upon to suit the mood of your music? Well, that's where the genius lies. Let's start with the string family. Whilst violins, violas, cellos, and double basses can create the greatest sense of busyness like this, the timbral hallmark of string instruments is their ability to produce the heart-wrenching beauty of a bowed string, a perpetually sustained sound, the vibrato shimmering on every note, a soft bed of sound. It is for good reason that in this most intimate of moments, Beethoven called on these instruments. None can match the sound of emotional fragility produced by the string family. Sorry guys, bit emotional there. Let's take a look at the woodwind family. The woodwind, or just wind family in this case, two oboes, two flutes, two clarinets and two bassoons, have a beautifully clean and pure sound. Their timbre is unmuddied. Because this clarity of sound cuts through the rest of the music, Beethoven often uses this to outline harmonies by combining the wind instruments in rhythmic unison. The woodwind timbre also lends itself to solo melodies. Beethoven often employs an oboe, clarinet or flute to carry a solo line. Their clean and pure sound easily cutting across the whole orchestra. Thanks, Ben. That's Maestro Benjamin Northey, our conductor. We'll be coming back to him and the role of the conductor later on in the series. Now let's do a direct comparison with the timbral difference between the strings and the winds, as they trade phrases in a musical conversation. Behind the winds, of course, we have our brass. In this classical orchestra, Beethoven keeps it simple with two trumpets and two horns. In the orchestras required by later composers, we'd be used to seeing trombones and tubas as well. Timbrally, we all know what brass instruments sound like. In fact, they sound almost exactly as they look: bright, shiny, regal, and with the ability to produce a great deal of sound. Throughout his Seventh Symphony, Beethoven saves the brass to push our emotions to the next level. Just when we think this relatively small symphony orchestra couldn't rival one of the grander romantic proportions, Beethoven deploys the brass with dramatic effect. Last but not least, our last family in our orchestration toolbox: percussion. I'm sure you all know what percussion encompasses: struck instruments, from gongs, triangles, rain sticks, cymbals, bass drums, snares, tambourines, and bells, to name a few. However, have you really thought about percussion's timbral purpose in a symphony orchestra? Many would assume they are there to keep a beat, like they do in popular music, providing that rhythmic drive. However, as Beethoven so perfectly displays, orchestral percussion create impact with colourful timbral variation for dramatic effect. In this case, Beethoven simply uses two timpani to accentuate the grandest and most dramatic moments in the music. You can see why the symphony orchestra has endured over time. With so many amazing combinations of timbre for audience to listen to and composers to express their music with, the possibilities for new and exciting music that excite and move us are just endless. Speaking of combinations, we forgot one. The orchestral hit, which is what we like to call it when you slap all those families together in unison fortissimo. We get that powerful orchestral hit sound. And on that note, I'm Richard Vaudrey, and this is the Melbourne Symphony Orchestra. See you next time.
Thank you.